So in previous lecture we have seen installation of CCS, then we have written some simple program about LED blinking and how to build that program and how to debug it into the microcontroller. So and in today's lecture we will see some important parts of programming which are important for us, like mechatronics applications particularly, like interrupt service routine, then PWM and quadrature encoder interfacing like QEI. So this we will look at these modules and we will debug that program into the microcontroller. And I am having a DC motor with me, so you can see. So this is a DC motor with encoder. This is the encoder. You might have seen this motor image in lectures also. So this is motor with encoder, and this is connected through this L298 motor driver, which is nothing but the double edged bridge, like full edged bridge circuit, and this is connected to the TIVA microcontroller. So we will write this program and build it into the this microcontroller, and we will run the motor and we can read the actual values of inputs like position and direction and speed of the motor. So yes, we will start now from so we will first of all this we will start this code composer studio, and I have already written codes for this ISR routine and PWM and QEI, all these things, because it will take too much time to write the program again. So and we are going to share these programs with you also, so you can see that programs also. So just we will like overlook about with this programming. So this is a previous workspace which we have created, I think. Yes, so we will launch this one only. Till it is starting, you are having this workshop PDF with you. So in that PDF, lab number 6, I think, lab number 4 is about interrupts and timers, you can see. So you can look at this. This is also giving the interrupt service routine program. So what is interrupt and how it works. So already you learned that in the lectures, like what is interrupt and what is ISR and what is the significance of that. So you have already learned that. So just for now we will look at how to program it in CCS. So yes, so this is the lab 4. You can go through this lab also, so you can get some idea about this interrupts. So basically this program is for blinking LEDs with some delay. So you can yourself try this program and run that program also, but for now we will look at our program. So yes. So yes, in this, yes, so this view, this is our Project Explorer, and here, okay, so we will write the program for or we will look at the program for LED blinking using ISR or interrupt service routine. So we will create new project. So new project, Code Composer Studio, CCS project. Next, here our target is Tiwaz C series, GH6PM, and debug interface is stereo DC circuit. And so it has name as ISR for onboard ELEDs. So integrate with main.c and finish. Yes, so I have copied that program. I am going to paste it here. So for now, just I will tell you. So for now, I will take it. This program is basically it is including some like PWM also and QEI also. So we will first of all we will delete that, because we are particularly we are going to look at ISR only for now, and then we will go to the QEI and this PWM also. So PWM also we will delete. So we are not needing this PWM at all. Yes. Okay, so this is also not needed. So okay, yes. So we are going to use interrupt, so this is should be included, and this is also should be included. Yes, so this is our program. Like these are header files, then some of the functions, like we are not going to use this PWM or timer, and sorry, timer is going to use. So QEI and this PWM function in this program we are not going to use, so it is not needed, or you can keep. It will behave as a redundant one. So yes, these are functions for like this. This is timer init is for timer initialization, and LED is for LED blinking program. Like you can see here on this function, you can get directly what is written at that function. Also for here also, yeah. So we will going to look at it. So PWM frequency is also not needed, and yes. So this is main function. So here we have already seen that here we have like used this system divisor of 5 and this PLL of 16 megahertz. So our frequency is 40 megahertz now. Then this is for like enabling the PWM model GPIO-D, but however we are not going to use that, so it doesn't matter. Also this GPIO-C is for QEI module, same, and this GPIO-F, like port EF, is for onboard LEDs. So we are for now only going to use this GPIO-F, because we are only targeting our onboard LEDs and ISR through this. So we are so GPIO pin type, GPIO output. So we have made these pins 1, 2, 3 as output pins, and now we are calling these functions now in main function only. So PWM, this is not required. So timer init. So what after this, like enabling these peripherals like port EF, what will it do? It will like run this function timer init. And what is timer init function? So timer init is initializing the timer. So for any interrupt or interrupt service routine, we need to define one timer for that particular interrupt service routine. So here in Tiwa we are having a number of timers, like timer 0, timer 1, and like timer A 0, timer A 1, timer B 0, timer B 1. Like that type of timers we are having. So we can have number of interrupt service routines for that purpose. Like we can use different timers for different applications. So for now, this timer initialization function is for ISR routine that we are going to use. So it is enabling the peripheral enable. So this is a peripheral enable. So which is going to enable this timer 0 because we are going to use timer 0. That's why. Then this is a configuration of the timer. So it is like there are many functions like timer CFG periodic or some different configuration will be there. So we are using this period as a periodic. So all these functions like system control peripheral enable or timer configuration or timer load set int enable, all these of this type of function you will get here in this PDF, like TIVA functions PDF, which we have already shared with you. So in that you will get this all these functions. So for example, just for now I will tell you about these timers, like so yes, this 29 chapter is for timer, and this in API functions you can see there are number of functions are there, like timer ADC event get, timer ADC event set, like that. So for now we have used this timer configure. So in timer configure we have done this, the whatever timer we are going to use, we have to provide its base address, which is timer 0 address. You can see here also key, that is timer configured, and the first input to this function is should be, or first argument is the base address of the particular timer that we are using, and then how to configure it. So it will like after clicking on this function also you will get more about you will get to know more about this function. So for example, this is now timer configure function, and here it is giving the what is the parameters actually. So this is the base, is the base address of the timer module, and it is the configuration of the timer. So description is also there, like for example what type of in which different ways we can configure the timer. So that the timer can be configured to be as like a full width timer, like timer CFG, or half width timer A, timer B, like that. So the number of different ways to configure the timer. So of this, among this we are using this timer CFG periodic. So I am going to tell you this because whenever you are going to write the program, you should go to this particular PDF, and you will get to know what is this we can say the function of each this API function, like what this API function is doing. So anything like for example, for now we will see that's what the system control peripheral enable means. So system control peripheral enable means what? So here I think it should be in the system control, yes, and API functions. So yes, you can get here system control clock set, which is the basic or first line we can say, where we are going to set our clock frequency. So here after clicking on that you can get, so this is the this is required configuration of the device clocking. So you can see here there is the division 1, division 2, division 3, like that up to 64. Also the use of PLL, either we will use PLL or we can use as an oscillator. So that, and external crystal frequencies can be chosen in this way. So you can see there are like number of ways and number of different arguments that can be done, that can be given in this particular function or any different particular functions. All these arguments or what should be written in that function is provided in this PDF under this section. So you can click on any function you want, and you can go, you can search for this description, and you can see what this should be written inside in here. Like for example, you can see here like number of external crystal frequencies are there, and of which we are using this 16 megahertz. So that type of study you can do yourself to get to know what is like what is the significance of different API functions, and so that you can write your own programs in different ways with different many types or many different ways you can write your program. So again, one particular function I will tell about it. And okay, so we after that we will look at the next part of the program. So system control peripherally enabled, that is a particular function which is we are using every time. So this one, system control peripheral enable. So you can see here, so this argument which is given to the function is a peripheral to be enabled. So which peripheral unit we want to enable, we have to give its name, or we can basically say its address maybe, like it is port AF or port D, or it is QVI module, or it is PWM module, or it is a timer module. Whatever peripheral we want to enable, it can be given inside here in this function. So you can see this is GPIO B, GPIO E, GPIO C. We have switched on this GPIO F for LEDs, or this is PWM. We are going to use this PWM1 in our next program, or QVI1, QVI0. So this type of different arguments are there, and you should follow this particular value or this particular functions, because it will otherwise the program will not get built, because if there is any spelling mistake or any mismatch in these functions and your return functions, then your program will not get built. So yes, for now, so you can see this system. We have seen this API function and system control peripheral enable also, and this GPIO output makes this. So I can say this GPIO pin input pin type GPIO output is what this function will make the pins as a output pins, general purpose input output or digital output pins, we can say. So here argument is first of all the base address of the port, and then the which pins are to be made output pins in that particular port. So port is F and pins are 1, 2, 3, like PF1, PF2, and PF3. So this is the argument, we can say. So we are not needing this particular any peripheral, so we can comment it out for this particular program. And yes, so where we are, okay, so this is timer configure. Okay, so there is like the period of the timer, like we can say after, like it particularly it will show the it will be for the frequency of ISR. So how frequently ISR should be called, or interrupt service routine should be in function, that particular frequency we can set here by using this timer load set. And in this timer load set, this UI32 period is one of the argument, which is nothing but the timer, like for example, or time period we can say. So for example, it is system control clock gate, means whatever frequency we have set as a clock frequency, that one divided by 10 means that particular frequency will be 1 second, and divided by 10 means 0.1 second, like that. So here particularly we are loading this timer with 0.1 period, so our ISR will be in service, or we can say this ISR will be called after each 0.1 second, like that. So yes, then we have enabled this interrupt enable, then timer interrupt enable, then interrupt master enable, and then finally timer enable. So all these modules should be enabled, and this is the program you will also get to know from here also, from this lab. So you can see here, this is int enable, time int enable, int master enable, like that. So yes, and this LED, so it is just making pin, I think 2 means it is making pin, so red LED on and off, that's it. So it is providing, if it is on then make it off, otherwise make it on, like that. So I will show that. So you will concentrate, you should concentrate on this function. This is interrupt handler function, or we can say interrupt service routine. So whenever this timer is calling the ISR, our program will execute this particular function. So this is function. What this function does, first in first line only, it will clear first of all this timer int clear. So because it is clearing this interrupt, otherwise our timer will not call again and again. So it should be cleared. Then again this timer enable will be enabled. then the function will be called, and again it is clear when it will enable, like that this cycle will be there. And then what is what this this is actual count means, actual count is giving call to this ENID function, and our ENID function is what? It will make pin on and off, sorry, read ENID on and off. So basically in first call it will make ENID on, then second call it will make ENID off. So as we are going to call ISR, or we are executing this ISR, then it will turn on and off the read ENID. And this actual count we have provided here because we will see when this program is built, we can count this like how much time this function is called and how this frequency, particular frequency, is affecting the ISR. So you can see that because this ENID function is going to return this count. So count is equal to count plus 1 and initial value of count is 0. Then each time this function is called, it will increase the count by 1, and that particular count is this actual count. Okay. So here we have already declared these functions. And now you will wonder about, we haven't defined this particular function, that's timer 0 int handler. This function is nowhere defined here in this program, or even nowhere called here, like in main function as well as in timer function, we haven't called this particular function. Then how the program will get executed? So yes, this is what the interrupt service routine. So basically, when our interrupt is enabled after this frequency, it will automatically call this function. But how this function is will get called, we will look at it. So first of all, we will build this program. We will check errors. So yes, okay, you can see it is not built because we haven't provided the paths for this library files. So here you should remember in previous lecture only we said in this properties in ARM compiler include options, we have to give path for this particular TVAware installation file or folder, this one. And okay, then in ARM linker file search path, we have to provide this driver lib file. So I say this in TI, then this TVAware software folder, then driver lib, then CCS debug and driver lib.lib. So yes, open. So yes, now our program should be built successfully. Okay, so there is some error. It is showing some error that this UI32 period is not defined. Yes, because we have, while deleting, we have by mistake deleted this also. So we will define it again. Uint, so 32-bit integer. Yes, we will initialize it for 0 and look at now. Okay, yes, so our program is not is built successfully without any error. So we will now go for debugging it on a microcontroller. So I have attached already the microcontroller and yes. Yeah. So you can see here I am in my microcontroller. This one. And even if we have now run the program or resumed the program, then still the read ENID is not blinking. Why so? Like even our program is not having any error, or then also this ENID is not blinking. And the reason is, so yes, because this function is not getting called. So now to make this function called, we need to change something that you should look at carefully. So that particular thing you will also get in this lab file also. So in this program of ISR, you have to go through into this base file, that is DM4C123, the startup file. And in that startup file, we have to make one change, or we can say two changes. Like we have to define this function in that startup file. So under here, you can see here, this is external function. So external void and this function. So void is double. Yeah. So we have to define this function here in the startup file. And also you have seen ki we have used this timer A of timer 0 base. So here under this timer 0 sub timer A, so you can see here there are lots of interrupt handler functions. So for like we can say first of all it is these are some default interrupt handler functions for each, like GPIO port A, B, C, D, UART, SSI, PWM. These type of like peripherals are having these interrupt functions, interrupt handler functions, default interrupt handler functions, and of which we have selected this timer 0 sub timer A. And so we have to change this function name to ours, which we have defined. Then only our program will run successfully. So here we have changed its name to timer 0 interrupt int handler. Whatever name we have given here, that name should be copied. And yes, control yes to save this. And now you can see, now you will be debug it. Yes, now it is debugged successfully. And now, okay, then let's show you. This is, and now, yeah, so this red LED is now blinking with 0.1 second, we can say, delay. And, or whatever frequency we have provided. And now, this actual count we can count it by using add to watch expression, then OK, and here continuous regression. So you can see this is the 0.1 second frequency. So it is running with that much frequency, or it is increasing by that much frequency. So after each one count, like at one count, it, the LED is off. After and at another count, it will LED will turn on like that. So this is just for showing you how this ISR is working. And yes, it is working and its count is changing. And yes, so this actual count is from this is value changing because we are this in this ISR or this particular interrupt handler function we are calling this LED. And now we can change it to the 1 second time like this, and we can debug it again. Now you can see, we will watch this again here in expressions. You can see this change value changing after 1 second. So now we have changed the frequency, or we can say interrupt handler frequency to this to the 1 second. So its value changing as a 1 second. So yes, we have also provided this program to you. You can go through this program and you can like play through it. You can do stuff as useful for you, and you can define this different, you can use different frequencies and different types of, so you can play around this API functions also, and you can go through the functions actually what these API functions are doing. And then you will learn this programming. Yes, thank you. So yes, now we have seen the basic ISR, what is interrupt service routine. Now we will look at PWM for now. like just PWM, and then we will look at a QEI module, like that is quadrature encoder interfacing module. Okay, so we will go to the PWM. So new CCS project TURC GH6PM this, and here we can write PWM for onboard LEDs. So for now I am just providing this PWM for onboard LEDs, and you can see as the PWM duty cycle is changing, the brightness of the LED will go on increasing and decreasing according to the PWM duty cycle. So yes, finish. Okay, we will just copy paste that program which I have written already. So onboard LED PWM, and yes, this is. So yeah, I have copy pasted that program now. We will go through it. So these are library files, you can see. So here pwm.h file is added now because we are going to use pwm like that. So yes, this UI adjust is for adjusting the duty cycle, it is variable, and I is for like for loop like changing this duty cycle. Okay, so yes, this is hardware initialization. This peripheral variables like GPIOF, because EF is port which is having onboard LEDs connected to onboard LEDs, and then we have enabled this PWM1 module, and then clock set by this. You can go through this. Actually, you can all go through this different API functions. So what is PWM clock set and how it can be set? Like what should be input here? So these things you can see yourself, because like for example it is 64, so the reason factor is 64, like that. So I will say you should go to this PDF, that TY functions, and here just I will go to this PWM, then PWM API functions, and PWM clock set. Yes, PWM clock set, or so you can see here PWM clock set, it can be division 64 or division 32, division 16, like 16, 84, like that. So you can go to there and you can set the PWM clock. Otherwise also in 16 control, also using this function you can set this PWM clock like that. So I will not go through all these functions, because you can go through these functions actually, and you can learn that functions, no issue. So this is GPIO pin type PWM it is making this port EF may PF1, PF2, PF3 pins as a GPIO pin, as a PWM pins. So this is wrong, this is actually PF1, PF2, PF3, like that, it is PWM pin. So ignore this one. I will change it before going to upload for you guys. Yes. So this is PF. This is configuring PF1 pin as PWM module E1 and PWM output 5, like that. PWM 1 output 6. PWM 1 output 7. So PF1, PF2, and PF3. All these things. So you cannot do like PF2 as a PWM file. No, you cannot do that. So each function, each pin has its particular functions, or we can say different functions, but that are already defined. We cannot switch functions from each from different. Like you can see in this data sheet, you can see here, I think pin diagram or signal tables. So here what we are looking for, PF1. So yes, PF1, so PF1, so you can see in PF, this PF1 pin can be configured as analog comparator or PWM, PWM 5, which is motion control module 1, PWM 5. So, or we can configure it as a QAI module 0 phase B. Like we can use this pin as a QAI pin also, like that. So different functions can be assigned to particular pin, but at a time it can do only one function, as well as like you cannot write program without looking to this data sheet, because you can see this PF1 is written as a mode PWM file. So this is making this PWM. So this is configuring this PF1 pin as a PWM pin. But you cannot write PWM6 here, because that PWM6 is assigned for to this PF2. So like that, you should go to this data sheets while writing the program. Then only you can see which pins can be written as which pins, like that. So yeah, so PWM generator configure. This is mode down. You have already seen lectures like this. There is up and down and only down, like that. So this is configuration. Then period set, it is maximum period, like 100. Now I am giving, it means period of the PWM. Like for example, if it is set at 100 and we are going to provide this pulse width as 50, it means 50% duty cycle. Or if we are going to provide the PWM width as 80, then it is the PWM duty cycle will be 80% or 80% duty cycle. So it will depend on this period. But in later lecture I will just tell you, we cannot set this period directly as this. Like we can save, but whenever we are going to use this for particular thermodynamics applications like DC motors, then this period is depending on the PWM frequency which we are going to use. So here we are just going to apply this PWM to LEDs, so it will not matter that much. But when we are going for mechatronics applications, then we should know at which frequency this PWM signal should be provided to the motor. And according to that particular frequency, this value will change. So you can go through this Launchpad workshop, and here I think there after 10 or 11 lab is for PWM. So 11, 12. So yes, see, this 14 is for 15 is for PWM. You can go through this particular lab and you will also get to know more about this. So before coming to this programming, you should go to like respective lab in this workshop file, so you will get better ideas. Yeah, so this is period set, then PWM output state. So output state is 5, 6 and 7 bit of this PWM1 is true, that is we are making it as output, PWM output. And now we have enabled these generators, PWM generators. So all these things you can get from the data sheet. Like for example, just I will show you. So when you see this data sheet, this particular is attached to the generator 2, PWM generator 2. And this one is operated by PWM generator 3, like that. So we have enabled this PWM2, generator 2, as well as generator 3, and PWM7, which is also operated by generator 3 only. So these two and they are enabled now. And now in our while loop, what we have done is we have first of all defined like from I1 to 21, and we have changed this EY just as I into 5. So first value of is will be 5, and then its final value is 100, like that. So our duty cycle will be changed from 5% to 100% duty cycle. So here pulse PWM pulse width the set, we are giving its width as a UI8 adjust. So for each loop, this particular PWM width, or we can say duty cycle in other words, will change. And then we have provided this delay. So we can say this delay as not of 1 second. You can you I will give this to you to find out how this will be 1 second, or what is this sorry. So how to make this as 1 second or minus, so 10 minutes, so 10 milliseconds we can say, or anything. So you can find out that. and this A is giving us the A is equal to PWM with gate. So it is set and this is gate. So gate, it will give us the particular value of this PWM pulse width. So for now, you can see I have only used PWM 5 because they are just we will just look at red LED and not for other LEDs. So yes, this A is already defined. Yeah. So now we will go to properties, then include options here, browse, and DI this folder. So okay. And ARM linker file source path here. Yes, okay. So now our program should be error-free. We will look at it. Build. Yes, so this is now without any error. Now we will build this program. Sorry, debug this program onto the TGOR launchpad. And now I will show you. So currently this is our launchpad. So these like ignore these wirings. These wirings are like encoder wiring, which we will look at after this one. So yeah. Now I'm going to resume this. So this particular I will say okay, so this is actually because now this blue LED is always on because of this PWM module. And that's why we are not only getting red LED. So just we will make some change that instead of this we will make as output 6. And but one thing I will show that our program is not wrong. Because just I will show you. So keep it as a 5 only. And yeah, so we will run it. So you can see here the A. And what is A? And yes, this value you can look at 5, 10, 20, 25, like that. It is changing by 5. So the speed of your bit is changing or duty cycle is changing from 5 to 100. So the program is okay, but this blue LED is also on, and that's why we are not going to get exact idea. So just I will change this to 6 and we will look whether it is now giving. So yes, it is giving, but I don't think from camera you can recognize it. Now I think you will get this intensity is changing, how this intensity is changing. But maybe not, I don't know because from camera whether you will be able to see this change in the brightness because it is like a little one and difficult to recognize from camera. So just we will look at, so you see, this is obtained like that. So this particular brightness is changing. From 0 you will recognize it actually. Otherwise it is looking as the same only. Means for you I can recognize it, but I don't think you can recognize this change. Still you can look at when it is becoming 0. So yeah, it is brightness changing and now increasing like that. So in this way the PWM is working. So you can I will provide this we are going to provide this particular program also with you. You can try this program and you can see the speed of your brightness is changing. And you can play with different LEDs like red, blue and green. And these LEDs are one body LEDs and you can see the changes in the brightness. And otherwise, you guys, if you are having any external LED or bulb, like small LED, you can say, you can provide that the speed of the signal to that one there also, so that to change also, you can say so that to recognize this change. And actually, the speed of the signal should be given to the like we are going to use for semiconductor applications like a DC motor. Where we can control the speed of the DC motor. So here it is for we can say the first glimpse of or the first idea of the PWM, we have given it to the LED. So as this brightness of LED is changing, in that way we can change the speed of the motor. So I will show that also. So yes, this is PWM. Now we will look at QEI module, which is quadrature encoder interface. So basically that is not given in this workshop, so you can look it carefully. We will build one program for that. So particularly that QEI module is what it is going to do. It is capturing the signals from quadrature encoder or like rotary or linear encoders, which are having channels as A, B or an index channel. And we can obtain the position, velocity and the direction of the either rotation or linear movement from this interface. Like QEI, we can say as a simple QEI. We are not, I will rotate the motor by my hand only and we will going to recognize the changing position or speed. So let's finish. Here only I have done is also this is give you a real encoder data and this main dot c. So this is like we will provide this program with also you also. So just I will let you know what is it. Like these are library files and here this QEI library file is now added. Because we are going to use this QEI model. And yes, this position and velocity and RPM direction are the variables for the recording. And PPR, you should know or you may know or you can study this encoder. So the PPR is what like per revolution, the how many counts are there, what is CPR and PPR, and how this quadrature encoder works and how it will make this count useful in this our we can say calculation of the velocity and all these things. So yes, this is hardware initialization enable periphery of GPIO D because we are using port D as a QEI module. So I will show you this port D. We are going to use QEI module because the pins like PD7 and PD6 and PD7 are the pins which can be configured as a QEI pins. So we have enabled this GPIO port D. So you can see this PD7. Okay, PD3. So yes, this is PD7. So PD7 pin can be configured as PHB0, that is QEI module 0 phase B. And where is PD6? PD6. Okay, so this is PD6 and this PD6 can also configured as PHA0, which is QEI module 0 phase A. So here we have enabled this particular port D. Similarly, you can use port C also. I think on port C, the PC5 and PC6 pins can be configured as QAI pins. So you should go to this data sheet to recognize all these things. So what pins should be, which pins should be used and all these things. And now port D we have enabled, and on port D, the QAI module is QAI0. So there are two modules, QAI1 or QAI0. So as we have using port D or PD6 and PD7, so we should enable this QAI0. And now this is one step that whenever, like you can see on this workshop file also, while going to use this switch program. So how to use this onboard switch provided on Tiva, you need to unlock that particular key. So they are not, this is not needed for all the keys, but there are particular keys like this PD7 or again I think PC5. For these pins, we need to unlock these pins because they are configured as another, and particular at first they are locked with particular function only. So we need to unlock this. So for PD7 only we need to do that, not for all the pins. That pins you can get it from here, the data sheet also, that which pins are to be unlocked or not. These things you can get. And also while programming, when particular pin is not working, then you will get to know, oh, there is something wrong. And you will go to the data sheet and you can search like that. Okay, so this PD6 and PD7 pins are we now made as a pin type QVI. We have already used this type of functionality, GPIO pin type, GPIO output or PWM, and now we are using it as a QVI. So this is, and it is now configured as PD6 should be used as PH0, PD7 it should be used as PHB as provided in the data sheet. And now before going to configuration, this configure this QVI, we have to disable this QVI module and interrupt the QVI, and then configure it as a, you can go to this, like I will go and so in QVI API functions, QVI configure. So yeah, so here you can see you have to provide first of all base. So we are using QVI module 0, so QVI 0 is the base. And now we can configure it as a many different ways. Like you can see, either you can capture only A or you can capture A and B. So here we have provided it as a capture both A and B. What is A and B? These are the signals from encoder, like channel A and channel B. Then whether it should be reset on index pin or it should not reset, like that. Like for example, after reaching this 1336 value, it will again go come to the zero, like that. So we can provide it whether it should be reset or we have to not, we don't need to reset it, like that. So I will tell about this value also just shortly. Then it can be, the QVI can be configured as a quadrature or as a clock and direction. You might have seen that in lectures also. And here we have configured it as a quadrature encoder, and it is a swap is needed or not. So swap, which means like if our by mistake provided this channel A pin to the PD6 on board, like the physically this pin from the motor or encoder is channel A, and by mistake we have attached it to the PD7, and channel B is attached to the PD6. Then in that case you might need to swap the configuration. Like, but of course we can directly change it physically only. But if it is not possible, then you can go for swapping it. And now coming to this value, it is like we can say you can provide any value if you don't want to recognize this the rotation. We can say, so when one rotation is completed, if you do not need that, then you can go for any higher values. But for now, it is value like it is value of when 360 degrees completed, like 360 degree or one rotation of the motor is completed. At that time, it will reach the position of 1336. And It will again depend on this PPR value. So PPR into 4, it will give us this value, and it will reset. Like after reaching this value, it will again start from 0. So we can get to know it is now reached one rotation, then it is again starting from 0. Then one rotation, it is starting from 0, like that. So it will get reset. And now enable this QEI and also enable filter if you need. And also we have to configure this velocity also. So these are functions for velocity configuration. Like we need to divide it or not. So you might have studied it in lecture also during that by seeing this signal diagram for the QVI. And also at the same time you can go through this API functions. So I will suggest to go through all the API functions whenever you are seeing these programs uploaded to you or given to you. You should go to this QVI functions and you will get to know the functions then, like the arguments and why these functions are used here and all this. So QVI velocity enabled, we have enabled this QVI zero base. And now in while loop, we are getting this position, QVI position get, QVI zero base. So just keep in mind you are using this QVI zero because we have used this QVI zero. So there is QVI one also, which is provided on other pins like PC5, PC6, like that. Now we are getting this velocity, but we need to convert this velocity into the RPM and then the direction. So yes, this is the program, and I will show you. These are like connections, not connections, but so this is motor, and these two pins are for motor power, and these four pins are one is for encoder power, then one is for encoder ground, and two pins are channel A and channel B, and which are connected to the this our microphone, T1 microphone. So this motor you have seen already in the lectures, and now I think we have not. Okay, so we need to provide this path. Now our problem should be error free. You can see. Okay, yes. So it is built successfully. Now we will debug it. So just for now, I will like add this position to watch expression, then this RPM to watch expression. Now we will resume it. Okay, so program is now resumed, and now I will rotate the motor by hand. So you can see this position is changing. Okay, now I have removed by hand. And now as soon as I am going to like rotate it, the RPM value will increase, but as I am going to stop the rotation, then RPM will come down to zero. However, the position will be at the last position where I have stopped. So yes, so RPM is not there, then it is coming to zero. So now you can see the position is changing, and now it should be coming to zero after 1336 because we have provided that 1336. Yes, so you can see this is coming to the 1336. After 1336, it is coming to the zero. Now this motor is I cannot rotate very smoothly by hand, and so that its value is increasing. Even if I am rotating it slowly, but I cannot rotate it too slowly to go by one in like seven values in one by one. And now I will rotate it in another direction, so this position is like decreasing. Now increasing in another direction, like that. You can now if I am like directly just for you, I will just connect this motor's supply to the 5 volt supply for north. So you can see this velocity and position, how these velocity and positions are changing. So just wait for a minute, I will no, sorry. Yes, now I'm rotating the motor by 5 volt. You can see this constant velocity is there, like some change will be there, but almost constant. Oh, sorry, RPM. And the position is continuously increasing and coming down to 0 after 1336. And now I will change the direction. Now count is increasing. And after changing the direction, instead of increasing, it will go on decreasing. Like it will come from 1336 to 0, then 1336. Like that. So wait. This count is now decreasing. And however, velocity will be same because we are providing the same voltage, but in different direction only. That's the change only. So just wait, I will connect it so that we can see the. So now you can see this position and this velocity is changing, and we will just plot this position so you can see how the position is changing. Okay, so this graph. Yeah, and continuous refresh. Okay, so yes, it is going to 1336 and coming down to 0. So it is not too smooth because I have directly connected it to one small source and it might be fluctuating. But yes, in this way, so because it is now we have provided it in while loop, so it will take the time as required by the let's say. Are provided by this voltage, and according to the voltage, how much time it will take to reach the this our one rotation, and according to it will be like triangular because it is directly falling to the after one position, it will directly fall to the zero position. But the thing is here, the thing is now you can see that you can give any type of different waves, like you can say you can give rectangular signal to the motor, or sinusoidal signal to the motor, or trapezoidal signal, triangular signal, like that. You can by using what? The PWM duty cycle. So you can write yourself the program where the PWM cycle is changing such way that it is rectangular. So if PWM is rectangular, then it will provide the speed diagram will be rectangular, like that. The position diagram will change accordingly, but you can control the position also using the speed of PWM, because you can write the program, because now you are having this position count, you are having the RPM, and you can change the RPM by using PWM, by using H bridge or L298 motor driver. You can see the data sheet of H bridge, how this H bridge works, how to provide the PWM signal to the H bridge, and how to connect the motor to that, and change the speed using PWM. So programming is almost this similar one. Just you need to I can say combine all this which I have shown to you. Like I have first of all we have go through this ISR. Then PWM, then QVI. So basically you need to combine all these things to run your motor in the way you want, basically. So just I will give one just idea ki you need to read the encoder data, and using that encoder data in programming, you need to define your duty cycle to provide the I can say the PWD cycle to provide the speed range or speed signal or whatever signal you want to give to the motor. You can give it using this QVI and PWM both. And ISR you can use, of course, for this frequency of the signal to be provided. Like at, I can just say it is like rectangular or triangular, but to that you have to use this ISR and with different ISR frequency. So that part I will leave to you, that how to combine these different programs or different codes or different aspects of this DC motor, particularly for DC motor with the encoder, and how to run that motor as you want. And just another aspect is like by using this, not only you can provide the signal to the motor, but you can control the motor, like you can develop the PID controller or PD controller like that. So think about that and check how you can do that by using this QVI and PWM and the ISR. Okay, thank you.